Phillies won.
Phillies won.
Eagles won.
Eagles won. Remember, the weather is beautiful. I love the cool weather. I told you about my granddaughter who had a birthday last week. She sent me an email. Now tell me that doesn't sound weird. A 10-year-old sending an email. I know, in today's world it's not, but you know, I got my first email when I was a lot older than 10. So there's a number of things going on here in the community that you can be a part of, and I encourage you, any of you, to be a part of them as you are able. Many of them are listed in our worship folder to tell us about. A couple things. Remember, next week is the last week to sign up for God on Tap. Next week we'll have the effort of fair parking figured out. I think it's great that you're all people are signing up. I'm just cautious in the, how do you get the money back and forth, but I'm trusting that the Spirit will work through all of you to get that figured out. So that's the amazing work of God in this community. I did ask Ren, would you like to talk about your request for boxes and magazines?
Surely.
Surely? Surely. Let me give you a microphone.
Oh boy.
you might want to sit there.
If you break into a rat, I'll cut you off after 30 seconds.
No.
Okay, so we only know that one person heard you.
Neither do you.
So if you'll go to the part of your bulletin where the wonderful grace of Jesus is, okay? The first part is really very simple, very lovely, but as I told Pastor, the refrain is a mouthful. It goes really fast. So think of skipping along and trying to get the words and the music in at the same time. I figured we'd be done by the time you figure it out. So here is what we want to do. I want you to first look at the words, okay? And think of a skipping rhythm while you're doing it. So there's wonderful, the matchless grace of Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea. See how fast it goes? Roll higher than the mountain, sparkly like a fountain, all sufficient grace for even me, broader than the scope of my transgression. bring to heart that all my sin and shame. Oh, magnify the precious name of Jesus. Praise his name. Now, let me play the tune while you just watch the words. Okay, step two, listen for the tune.
sitting back here in case any of you, unless you got this thing, you're going to wait till I get up front and then raise your hand. I know Ren would do that.
Jesus, God is always making a new way for us. In Christ, you are.
communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We pray together. O Lord God,
merciful Judge,
you are an inexhaustible fountain of forgiveness. Replace our hearts of stone with the hearts that love and adore you, that we may delight in doing your will.
Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
You may be seated.
I would just like to announce that the postlude is two more variations of this same piece. So you're going to hear this thematically through the entire service.
First reading for this morning is from the book of Romans, the 14th chapter. The Christian community has significant struggles with diversity. Here Paul helps us understand that despite different practices in worship and personal piety, we do not judge one another. All Christians belong to the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for all of us and will judge each of us. Welcome those who are weak in faith, but not for the purpose of quarreling over opinions. Some believe in eating anything, while the weak eat only vegetables. Those who eat must not despise those who abstain. does not pass judgment on those who eat. For God has welcomed them. Who are you to pass judgment on servants of another? It is before their own Lord that they stand or fall. And they will be upheld, for the Lord is able to make them stand. Some judge one day to be better than another, while others judge all days to be alike. Let all be fully convinced in their own minds. Those who deserve the day, observe it in honor of the Lord. All those who eat, eat in honor of the Lord. Once they give thanks to God, while those who abstain, abstain in honor of the Lord and give thanks to God. We do not live to ourselves, and we do not die to ourselves. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So that whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, so that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother or sister? Or you, why do you despise your brother or sister? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us will be accountable to God. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
There's this fictitious law firm, which is a high-powered law firm in New York City, called, I'm going to use the current name that I'm familiar with, Pearson, Spector, and Litt. Typical law firm, big three high-powered names. Well, Harvey Specter is one of the partners in this law firm, and he was charged with hiring a new associate. He stumbled across this young man named Michael Ross. Now, here's the thing about Michael Ross. Michael Ross didn't really go to law school. But he could repeat verbatim everything in all the law books. And he knew what was going on. And Harvey Specter said, that'll hire you. Now, a few things about Harvey Specter. Harvey Specter is a high-power lawyer. He is the closer of the deal. He wants to make sure it gets done, and he doesn't care whose toes he steps on. Michael Ross, on the other hand, is a younger person who is approaching the law from a different point of view. He is offering grace to all of the clients that come to him. He's a bit more of a, I would call it, a humanitarian. He thinks about the people. So here we have these two high-powered lawyers in this firm, and of course they have hundreds of cases that they got to do. Well, it just so happens that the greater world, including the Bar Association, realizes that Michael Ross is a fraud because he didn't go to law school. The thing is he did go to law school, and it just wasn't exactly the way everybody else went to law school. He is convicted of his crime and he's in jail. He's put in jail. But while in jail, he comes across and starts thinking about more deeply about what it means to practice law. And for him, it seems to be about the person. What is really going on in that person's life? They screwed up, but you know, why do I need to punish them? So he is released from jail. Harvey sees that he is released from jail. And Mike says, I'm going to do pro bono work. You know what pro bono work is? Free law services for people. Michael actually kind of swaddles between Pearson, Spector, and Litt and working for the law clinic also in town, who helps other people who need law services but can't afford them. Pearson, Spector, Litt has never, ever, 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 ever done a pro bono case up until that point. Mike pleads with Harvey, and Harvey, we need to do this, we need to do this. Okay, do it, but. So long story short is Michael marries the Duchess of Sussex. Meghan Markle is the actress in this show. And anyway, they go off across the country, and now they are left without Mike. Harvey has a change of heart. Harvey has begun to see that the practice of law isn't about getting it right. forgiveness once, within 2 hours you're going to have to forgive someone else in the same day. Do you know the blessing and the curse about people? We're good and we're bad at the same time. We want to follow the law, but we also want a lot of grace. But how many of you want grace on your own terms? I want to forgive when I want to forgive. I want to forgive when I want to forgive. But if we were to really truly follow the teachings of Jesus, we would be forgiving all the time. There's a couple things that I learned in my short life, other than forgiveness is hard. Forgiveness is also a process. It's going to take time. It is going to take time. It's not like you go to the vending machine, you stick in your 50 cents, and you get your forgiveness pass and go, and done. No, it happens all the time. It happens all the time. Believe it or not, the church that professes forgiveness of others probably abuses it just as much as anybody else. The church, Big C Church, we say we practice forgiveness, but we've not exactly been a good example of it. Do you know why some people are not a part of the faith community? Do you know the number one reason that I hear not part of the faith community? Church is hypocritical. You know what a hypocrite does? Says one thing and does something else. If there's anything that I've shared with you that you latch onto, I hope it is that words are fine, but the actions is what matters. Actions are stronger than words. It's putting where it believes. As I was listening to the texts and things being read this morning, I'm like, you know, this forgiveness thing is going to be really easy too, if we got out of ourselves. As I was also reminiscing or trying to sit with like this text all week, it's been a hard week for me to, because it's like forgiveness is not one of those things that is easy to talk about either. It's not, I can't tell you you've got to forgive. It's something you have to figure out on your own. Something you've got to figure out on your own. I will say that I think the church is beginning to take some steps to forgive some of their past actions. With forgiveness also comes reconciliation. So to be able to forgive means you have an effort, you have a desire to reestablish a relationship with that person or persons. Truth be told, not all relations can be restored. And those that are restored will never be the same again. Will never be the same as what they were. But the forgiveness allows us to move on so that we can more fully embrace who God is. So a couple things that the church, the bigger church, has really not been really good about honoring and respecting is, you know, even in this country, how we obtained this land. Have any of you ever read this statement on the front of the bulletin cover? Anybody ever read it? Okay, as you all pick them out and try to figure out what is he talking about, it's what's called a land acknowledgement, that this land where we worship was not ours to begin with, but it was land that was occupied by the Susquehanna Indians. This land, we are caretakers of a land that was here Trust me, God wants you to wear clothes to church. And so do I. A couple of forgiveness stories of my own that I'm willing to share with you. One, you've heard about before, and that is, you know, I never expected to be here. I never expected to be here. Because 30 years ago, I was told, we don't like your company, not from here. But they were the ones that invited me back. That's the part of forgiveness toward reconciliation. The other way has to do with my relationship with my dad. You know, as a kid, I was a good rule follower. Any of you a rule follower? Or at least were at some point in your life? Yeah. Yeah, except I didn't know all the rules. I made a lot of assumptions about some of the rules. So for me, I saw how my dad treated other people. I thought he was being mean and angry to people. And I thought, well, if he's mean and angry to other people, he's going to be mean and angry to me. I better make sure that I toe the line. I toe the line. I was scared of my dad. I was scared. My dad never hurt me. Never physically hurt me. Never abused me verbally. But it took me 45 years to be able to forgive myself. Not him. Forgive myself. And it began with one small story that he told me that happened to him when he was 6 years old. And I began to understand more fully actions. You know, forgiveness is always about the actions, how we treat one another. How do we treat one another? When I learned my dad's story more fully and understood, I realized I was the one who messed up. I was the one who needed to forgive myself because I didn't understand enough about him. So today, when my dad and I get together, we always laugh at one another because I will say something, I said, and it's because of you that I am the way I am. Oh, because that was the other thing too. I was told that I was just like my dad and there was no way I wanted to be like my dad. No way! Sorry to inform you, I am just like my dad. Just like my dad. The art of forgiveness is not necessarily about the other person as it is about ourselves. The gift of forgiveness is that it's not gonna take away what happened. But the true act of forgiveness allows you to move on from where you were. To move on from where you were so that you might then continue to be a person of justice, love, and mercy. You know, when I want to offer those gifts of justice and love and mercy, I often want it to happen in my own terms, right? It's never going to happen in my terms. It will happen on your terms and how you build your relationships with people. So where's the good news in all of this? Where is the good news in all of this? The good news is that God already knows that we are going to mess can you imagine a world where we would learn to see that love is what the answer is, and showing mercy and forgiveness to others, forgiving their actions of how they treated me or others, and to hear more fully what their story is so that we might make it with them? That's the work of a person who follows Jesus, who engages in that work all of the time, to show mercy, to show kindness to all people. The church is actually a place where pro bono work happens all the time. We heard it about a Walmart store manager recognizing the people that come through his store. We heard it about someone who needed to clean up an accident and they just showed up. Forgiveness is about showing up, being kind, being patient, and returning love for love. Returning love for love. So let's all take a big breath, because we know that we don't really like to talk about forgiveness. Would you like a way to how to address forgiveness? Okay, you're going to get it anyway. So one of the things that I learned, and this is actually something that I tested on my father, it worked. How many of you have ever heard the art of using I statements? Do you know how to use I statements? Okay, I see a few looks of, yeah, and a lot of money. And another one's of like, you woke me up for that. I statements help us to say more clearly who we are. And it's not a way of being over somebody. It's about saying where I am with this relationship with you. So to give you an example, it would go something like this. I feel, fill in the blank, when you, fill in the blank, because, fill in the blank, what I need is, blah. Those are the things. I feel,
generous works of God. We pray for the church, creation, and the needs of our neighbors. We pray for the church. Bless the missions and ministries of diverse congregations, that they may uplift the good news of salvation in ways that can be understood. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and healing to rivers clogged with pollution. Enrich the soil for trees and plants. Protect the crops needed to feed those who hunger. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for all who govern. Encourage those in positions of power to lead with empathy, practice forgiveness, and care for those who struggle. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for our neighbors who face illness of any kind, for those strained financially, for all living with chronic pain, mental illness, the disease of addiction, or otherwise afraid of or in harm's way. Protect all who cry out for mercy, especially Deb, Sharon, Vicki, Eris, Scott, Jennifer, Dave, first responders in Chester County, persons impacted by the 9/11 devastation, for the grieving family of Walter Downs. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We pray for this congregation. Open our hearts to practice intentional invitation. Help us to forgive each other, practice patience, and choose welcome over judgment. Move us to care for those in our community seeking refuge and safety. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We give thanks to the saints who died in faith. Show us how to live faithfully, creatively, and lovingly in your church and world. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
Remember us according to your steadfast love as we offer these and the prayers of our heart, trusting in your compassion made known through Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
God of power, God of plenty, all things belong to you. We bring your gifts to the table that all might be fed. Form us into the body of your beloved, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The God of glory, Jesus Christ, name above all names, and the Spirit who lives in you, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
that God